worship here with us today. This is my first time doing morning announcements, so please excuse me if I seem nervous. First of all, we'd like to welcome back Reverend Joe Santiman. It's very nice to have him. Very important announcement. Stewardship committee will not be meeting today. In your bulletin it says they are, but they will not be meeting today after worship. Tomorrow is Memorial Day, so the church office will be closed, and Sharon does have the day off. But knowing her, she'll still be busy. The adult social group has a trip coming up to the Lakeview Cemetery. It'll be a Lolly the Trolley tour. The sign-ups are going on for that, and that's going to be on Saturday, June 17th. So if you're interested in that, they need 30 people in order to do that trip. So sign up on the bulletin board or contact Adria.
Okay,
On that trip, there's like about 12 seats left.
12 seats left.
Right, so it picks us up here, brings us back to that trip.
Okay, so you get picked up here, dropped off here, and it's starting at 2?
It picks us up at 10.
Oh, I'm sorry, pick
and
up at 10.
And we have 2.
Drop off at 10.
Like I said, there's 12 seats still available.
So 12 seats, so if you want to go, definitely get signed up for that. Summer Sunday school starts next week, June 4th. I'm not sure how the sign-up's going, but this is where we have different teachers fill in throughout the summer, aunts, uncles, grandmas, grandpas. And you don't have to have children to teach that in the summer. So please sign up for that. Again, I don't know how many spots are left for that. No experience is necessary. The garage sale has been postponed. That was going to take place July 8th, but due to circumstances with Rachel, we are going to be postponing that. So if you have treasures you wanted to bring, please don't leave those at home. The graduates will be recognized on June 11th. So if you have someone graduating from high school, college, or other schools of higher learning or any type of program, please fill out the form in your bulletin. I think those are all the bigger ones in the bulletin. I know my husband has an announcement for the search team.
So as you exit today, we're going to hand you a survey. It's a pretty simple, short, 6-question demographic survey. The information from this becomes part of the church profile that prospective new pastors would see. So it kind of gives them a statistical view of our church as well. Not a whole lot to it. It's one survey per family unit. So if you're a single family, that's awesome. If you're a family of 20, that's awesome. One form per family unit. At the top, there's a place for the name. You can, if you so desire, cut it off, tear it off. And there's a box that will be in Pilgrim Hall by me. If you want to separate your name from your survey, we really just need to know who has and has not turned in surveys, so we know who to hunt down in a couple weeks or not turn in the survey. So if you want to do that, you can just tear that corner off. There's a little envelope in the box, so you can drop your name in there and separate it from your survey. But it's pretty, there's directions on here. Like I said, it becomes part of the church profile that potential candidates see. Thank you. Yes?
How's the search going?
We're still developing the profile, so it's a long process.
And just a reminder, the search team has met twice already, and they're meeting almost on a weekly basis now. And the transition team, which I'm a part of, is still in place, and so the job of the transition team is to serve kind of as the, not mediator or go-between, but just someone that you can go to ask and talk to kind of get some input about where the search team is. Because as we know, they have a lot of work they need to get done and a lot to focus on. So the less we bother them with, the better. And the transition team, that's what we're there for. Are there any other announcements to come before the congregation? Okay, seeing none, let's begin our worship. If you are able, please rise and join me in the call to worship. Sin is always at work to counteract the good news of Christ.
But thanks be to God, the church is always at work, and we are glad to be a part of it.
Amen. No matter how ineffective our efforts may seem, there is always fertile soil which bears fruit for our labor.
We will continue to sow the seed of faith in Christ.
Christ, convinced that many will be responsive and come to Christ's kingdom. Amen.
Our first hymn is hymn number 21.
We just say a simple thing. I grew up at a time when I had a mother who, when she attended a program that was going on and then they were singing the national anthem and the man in front of her had his hat on and didn't take it off, she got a rock and, well, stone, not a rock. Got a stone, literally threw it at him before he took his hat. So that's the kind of background that I come from. And really, having grown up during a number of wars, the sacrifices that were made by both men and women with their very lives, and if not their lives, their service, that probably changed their lives for the rest of their being. And so it is appropriate that we take this time and not forget those who have served this country and believed that this is a home of the free and brave. Are there any other individuals that we need to remember this day in our prayers? Yes, ma'am.
Martha Weaver.
You have to wait till I get my pen out of here. By the way, I noticed my card is still here from last time. So I'll just go ahead and use them. Now.
Martha Lieber.
Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
My friend Elizabeth, who is in the hospital again with a chronic condition.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Let's pray especially for Rachel Zelensky, who is home from the hospital recovering from her heart surgery.
Rachel Zelensky. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
A little boy named Alex. He's been suffering from seizures and they don't know.
A young boy. Yes, sir.
Pat Lincoln is in the hospital and had a stroke. Some of you may know her husband, who was the minister at the UCC in Middleburg Heights for a number of years.
And I have a connection with a family. We went to school together. I don't know how he ever got out of the Methodist Church, but he did. Yes, ma'am. Kim and the last name of your book.
C-U-L-L-E-R.
Oh, colors, yes. Yes, ma'am. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir. By the way, thank you again.
Oh, you're very welcome. For all the men and women who are now serving and who have served, I think they deserve our prayers as well.
Very special day for all of us, and makes it even more special because this is a time in which you and I can come before God and bring our needs and know that they are heard. May we be in prayer. O Lord God, even though we have a list of names before us, we know that each of us, as we gather in this place, bring with us concerns, perhaps about our own lives or family members or friends. So hear us as we would lift those concerns before you in this time of prayer. Hear us. Prayers, O Lord. And hear us as we would lift our voice now in a simple expression of appreciation and praise. For we are told over and over again, and we have seen it done over and over again, when a the most natural tendency that we have as children of yours is to lift our voices in praise and thanksgiving. We praise not only your name, but we praise more importantly the way in which you touch our lives through the person of Jesus Christ. We are grateful for the way in which he has made known to us the depth of your love and concern for each of us gathered here. And certainly it humbles us, O Lord, to realize that one whom we say has power and might and majesty and in control of all of creation, that you would be concerned about someone like us. And so we do praise you, and we do thank you. And we thank you, O Lord, for your expressions of faith as witnessed by this congregation. We pray your blessing upon them in these times of transition, as so beautifully has been said. Come to these people, that they will continue to be a witness for you here in this place and time. And we ask, O Lord, that you would remember those names that have been mentioned, whether Martha, Elizabeth, Rachel, Alex, Pat, Kim, Don, and those celebrating birthdays, and more importantly, the men and women who serve this country this day. We know, O Lord, it is a much different world than when we gave recognition to those who have died for this country. We pray that even in those differences, there may be a sense not only of the courage and the strength that you can give them, but that you would guide them through this time as they affirm the reality of freedom and justice throughout the world. These are our prayers this day. Accept them in the name of Christ, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you see something else, share it. colors fading away. They see their son turning to gray. You can't share in a dream that you don't believe in. If you say that you see and pretend to be me, you won't be there. How can you ask if I'm happy going my way? Might as well ask a child at play. There is no need to discuss or understand me. I won't ask of myself to become something else. I'll just be me. Sings, no one asks why. I can see in myself wings as I feel them. If you see something else, share your thoughts and yourself.
Teddy Bickley. certificate. And we have also Roland, Riley, Christopher, and Kenzie. Thank you. I also would like to do a certificate for special vocal music for 2016 and 17. It goes to Connie, Gary, and then Bruce Kinnan, Pam Kinnan, Sarah Kinnan, who are on the vacation, Sandy, and I know Doug is here, so he's going to come and thank you, right? For special instrumental music, Audrey Bond, Barbara, Gary, Lisa, Brian, and Sharon.
Down here between all of you, because I have something to show you. Yeah, I know. Okay, that's fine. You don't mind sitting next to me, do you? No, okay. Well, these other folks are going to have a difficult time seeing all of this, because I'm going to open this up. What's in there? What does it look like? What does it look like?
Seeds.
Yeah, see them? Those are seeds. And it's interesting, if you put these in the ground, then you get something that might look like this. Isn't that amazing? From one little seed. Well, your parents and family members today are going to hear a message about seeds. But it also has to do with what helps the seed grow, and that's the dirt. And what they're going to hear is that the seed is all the stories about Jesus, okay? And that if you learn the stories about Jesus, this soil is like you and me. That's what it's all about. And that it's in our lives that we let that seed grow. So I'm going to give you a reminder of that. You take these and plant them and see what happens. You don't have to dig a deep hole, okay? So here's the seed to remind you of Jesus' teachings, okay? Be careful with these. You'll have to see some of them are coming out already. Oh. There. I'll have to give you these. Hold your hand down. it's Jesus' word, and that you're going to learn as much as you can by coming to Sunday school and at home to learn that word as well. And something else, a seed is also like a penny. You put a lot of pennies together and they grow. And you have an opportunity today in your offering, your pennies will help the food. Shall we take a moment for prayer and then you repeat the prayer along with me? Will you do that, please?
Yes.
Okay. Dear God, we thank you for your word. Like the seeds that grow. Help us, O Lord, to learn your words and live your words for Jesus. Amen. Okay, thank you. Hold on to those.
Should be recognized as Elena. We don't know how lucky we are to have her. I've been associated with many fine musicians through my life, and
she certainly ranks up with the best of them. So thank you for all you do.
And I say thank you as well. How many times I've said amen to what you presented, and I continue to do so, because your witness and song is a very important part of the worship experience. May we remember that as we present now our tithes and offerings before God. Something that is so substantial. These are our gifts, our financial gifts, for the building of a kingdom not made with hands, but certainly in the hearts of persons this day, whether in Strongsville or throughout the world. So accept these gifts and those who have given them. Bless and guide them for Christ's sake. Amen. You may be seated. Scripture lesson this morning is all too familiar, but I would hope and pray that we together may find new insights for our lives. Let us pray. Speak, Lord, through these lips, however unworthy, the wonderful words of life. Amen. Everyone knows the parable of the sower. In fact, I could ask any of you to get up and you could tell me, but can you tell me the meaning of this parable? The wonderful thing about Jesus is that he took a very simple form, storytelling, and brought a depth of meaning to an incident that everyone that he spoke to in his day understood, because they were farming people. They were the people of the land. And so he told this particular parable. But I want you to see it through different eyes today. I want you to see it through the eyes of a young preacher, a minister, a priest, whoever they be, whoever she may be. They stand before their congregation and they look into the faces of the people who are part of their congregation. And what do they see? Well, they see joy when the children sing. Sometimes there are tears because of a hymn that may be sung. But the preacher looks at these people. And this is what he says to God. In this instance, it's a he. Says simply, Lord, what will happen to these people? What will I be in their lives? How much a part of their lives will this congregation be? What will be the outcome? Hear now the word of the Lord as it comes to us. Chapter 8 of the Gospel of Luke, beginning with the 4th verse through the 8th verse, and then the 11th through the 15th verse. And by the way, you may turn to Matthew and Mark and find the same parable. People kept coming to Jesus from one town after another, and when a great crowd gathered, Jesus told them this parable. Once there was a man who went out to sow grain, and as he scattered the seed in the field, some of it fell along the path where it was stepped on, and the birds ate it up. Some of it fell on rocky ground, and when the plants sprouted, they dried up because the soil had no moisture. And some of the seed fell among thorn bushes, which grew up with the plants and choked them. And some seed fell in good soil, and the plants grew and bore grain, 100 grains each. And then Jesus explains this parable. This is what the parable means. The seed is the word of God. The seeds that fall along the path stand for those who hear, but the devil comes and takes the message away from their hearts in order to keep them from believing and being saved. The seed that fell on rocky ground stand for those who hear the message and receive it gladly, but it does not sink deep into them. They believe only for a while, but when the time of testing comes, they fall away. And the seeds that fell among the thorn bushes stand for those who hear, but the worries and riches and pleasures of this life crowd in to choke them, and their fruit never ripens. The seeds that fell in good soil stand for those who hear the message and retain it in a good, obedient heart. And they persist until they bear fruit. Well, that young clergyman heard those words, and he wondered if it would happen. But the reality was, he saw exactly what Jesus was talking about. When he thought in terms of the words of Christ coming to the people, that some of them did fall along the path. Well, we know what a path is like. It's packed down, it's hard, nothing can penetrate it, and it's almost like watching people walking on a main street. They're busy going to and fro, and they have an agenda all their own. They have to get from point A to point B, and they cannot be deterred. And certainly they're not thinking about the Word of God, because the issue is personal. And God somehow or other isn't in that part of their lives. And so they move rather quickly. And quite frankly, they don't take the time to even bother with worship. The minister knew that. But he also knew that the word of Christ came to people likened unto rocky ground. He knew that these people had heard the word. Perhaps it was on Sunday morning. Perhaps it was in a funeral. They heard the word. But when life itself crowded in, and some of the difficulties in life that came, whether it was loss of job, loss of a loved one, perhaps a miscommunication in a relationship with another person, and so when that time came, it wasn't to the church or to God's word that they turned. They became doubting people. Now, these are the kinds of people, oftentimes, that came to a church because they liked the youth director or they liked the minister. But when they left, they left. Rocky ground. Rocky ground. Then the minister thought about what Jesus said about those that fell among the thorns. Now they grew, the seed grew, but so did the thorns. And he knew exactly what Jesus was talking about. These are the people who oftentimes come to church and are very willing to be there on Sunday morning, and yes, they help out with the women's program or the youth program, whatever it may be. But whether they be young or old, there are groups that they spend their time with. For instance, I think of teenagers who are influenced by, guess what? Their peer group, people their age. And so they want to belong. They want to be a part of that group. And oftentimes it means denying that which they had learned when they came to Sunday school and church. And the adults, the same way. Oftentimes they become so involved, whether it's in a civic organization that becomes so much a part of their lives that that almost becomes first. Or perhaps it's, sorry to say, it's a sporting event. And oftentimes, it's that group of people that become as important as anything that a church or a congregation can offer. So what the preacher hopes for is the kind of seed that falls on good soil. That the words of Christ fall in a life that cultivates that relationship. These are the kinds of persons who not only hear the word, they hear it with their heart and their mind. And they respond to that word because it becomes primary in their lives. Not secondary, primary. And so they do everything in their power to nurture that. I teach a Bible study, and I have for a few years, And what I'm hearing from these people who are a part of it and have been a part of it, going to its fifth year, we know that it's difficult for us to understand the Word of God when we read it, and how much better it is that we can do it together and that we can grow together. That's what it's all about when you become the good soil for Christ's Word. So that when you finally hear that Word and come to an understanding of that Word for your lives, it makes a difference in the lives that you touch around you. And you become that living Word. They see you, they begin to understand what Christ is like. That's the wonder of it all. Well, the preacher obviously asks himself, oh Lord, how much of your Word will fall in good soil? The preacher became old and retired. And he went back and visited some of the churches that he had served. And this particular Sunday that he went to one church, there were two couples that he had married 25 years ago. They both lived out of town. They had come home to visit. Both couples active in the church where they were. And then they said to this minister, do you know that when we were married 25 years ago, you suggested something that was very necessary in our daily lives together? Not an ideal, something very practical. And it was so helpful to us. We get back to our own groups, the groups that we spend time with in the church and the community, and we found out they had the same problem. And guess what we did? We passed on what you had suggested. This same minister saw a gentleman came to him and said, you probably don't remember me, but I was in the hospital and you came, you stayed with me until the doctors gave us a diagnosis, you prayed with me, and what I learned from that experience was that I didn't need to worry that I should put my confidence and trust in Christ, and he would see me through. This man said, and he did. And I want to thank you. My friends, those are just two illustrations of many that you can perhaps add to the way in which your lives have been such that you have been good soil Christ's Word. And so even though the preacher found out that the seeds grew and matured, you as the people of God at the United Church of Christ in Schoenfeld are called to go and do likewise. Let us pray. We thank you, O Lord, for your Word. We thank you for the lives represented here this day, that they may be the good soil in which your Word is made real to those who walk through life. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen. May we stand and sing our concluding hymn. Thank you. this place, remembering what you have said and sung and prayed. Go then as those who have soiled a life that is rich and ready to receive Christ's word, that you may so live in this life, in the life to come, you may know the reality of his presence. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and evermore. Amen.